Hi. I'm Jacqueline Okumha. I am recently at the University of Pennsylvania, but I've been working with a whole team on this project, including Ryan Baker and Stefan Slater, who are also at Penn with me, but also the assessments team at WPI, and Sweet San Pedro has been instrumental in this as well, and Aaron Hahn is still at Teachers College. He was one of the students that didn't make us make the trip to UPenn with us this year. Today we're going to talk about report that we've designed based on prediction about whether or not kids will go to college, which were made using data from the assessments model. This is basically what the reports look like, and I'll have you take a good look now because I'm going to give you a bunch of slides that don't have them in the next few minutes. But basically, we're going to start by talking about what the assessments college prediction model is, so what kind of information is in it, and then we'll talk a little bit about framing effects, and so why we need design principles, and then finally we'll talk about the design principles in a way that's sort of integrated with the actual designs of the guidance counselor reports. We're going to start with assessments and the ACPM. The ACPM is the shortened version for the assessments college prediction model, and it is made from data from the assessment software system. Assessments is an intelligent tutoring system for middle school mathematics that provides scaffolding and support while assessing students who are doing primarily middle school math, although it is a platform that's designed to accommodate a wide variety of different topics. Now, the reason we're able to build these models is it is actually a full complicated system, and in addition to sort of basic measures of what the kids are doing, so the number of actions, the number of help requests, the percent they're correct, clicks, keystrokes, and timestamps, there's also some more complicated measures of learning, like Corbin Anderson's BKT, and measures of carelessness or slip. In addition to that, in the last several years, we've worked to develop sensor-free affect detection using the Bromp method. And this gives us models of boredom, confusion, engaged concentration, and frustration, all of which can be applied at the 22nd model. It also gives us two behaviors, gaming the system and off-task behavior, which are also applied at the 22nd interval within the log files. Now, for this study, we used data for almost 4,000 students who'd used the system within a two-year school year period. In about 2004 to 2006. And as these students were entering college, we went to the National Student Clearinghouse and obtained information about which ones of them had enrolled in the United States. And since they keep track records of all the US colleges, we have a fairly robust idea of who got to college in a timely manner and who didn't. Right? So we used this college attendance records as the training label for who did and didn't make it to college, and it turned out that several of these features were pretty important in following that following up on those kids, and we ended up with a logarithmic model of college enrollment with six different features that turned out to be important that were related to student engagement and learning. The challenge with this is that we not just have to get it to a friendly guidance counselor, we hope, but also to a middle school student. So this guidance counselor is going to act as a filter through which the data and the models are going to be transmitted to whoever it is that we're trying to make an impact upon. So the first thing we did was work with those guidance counselors to identify things that would be particularly useful, and certainly whether or not we thought the kid would go to college was right up there at the top of the list. But that also turns out that some of these other learning engagement factors and the kids' performance or relative performance was also something they thought could be pretty useful when they were trying to figure out what it was that they should probably talk to these kids and counsel them about. We also worked with them and discovered that figuring out, you know, if there was just one thing that we had time to target, the lowest performing factor in that prediction of whether or not they go to college would probably be the most efficient way, since guidance counselors tend to be pretty busy people. And since they also do some work with students in groups, having ways to display data about more than one student was also important. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about framing effects, and I think, you know, probably it's a review for a lot of people. Like I said, we did work with the guidance counselors very closely, and Aaron Hahn, who's one of our graduate students at Columbia, and Ryan Baker as well, worked really hard on this part of the project and just interfacing with those guidance counselors. But we also didn't want to take up too much of their time. And so before we even started meeting with them, we were already looking at the literature on risk communication, a lot of which is in the medical field, although it's in a number of other fields as well, and also at student feedback theories. However, I would say both of these are sort of underlyingly what you might call framing effects. Right? So a lot of people think about framing effects as, you know, if you put the Jackson Pollock in a really silly frame, nobody would take it seriously. But if you found it on a nice museum and with a nice museum frame, then suddenly it's worth more. But framing effects are actually sort of a perceptual effect. And so if you put something in a yellow frame, you might notice different colors than if you put it in a blue frame. And language very much acts like things in a perceptual system. So the way that we speak about things definitely causes people to filter that information in different ways. And they've shown this even with people who would be considered fairly expert in their knowledge of statistics. So medical doctors certainly have lots and lots of training in statistics, but also engineers and judges. And what we find is if you say, well, 30 of the 50 last projects or last defendants succeeded, then, you know, they're pretty willing to help. Whereas if you give them the same kind of information in a different frame, they're much more reluctant to take any risks. Sometimes the medical terminology is a little differently. Sometimes if you frame it negatively, you actually find that they are more likely to take risks, which is maybe particularly troublesome when you think about a student coming before a guidance counselor. We want to make sure that we're framing these things in a way that that guidance counselor is inclined from the get-go, with other their perceptual biases are, to frame things as positively as possible for those kids. We also don't know what kind of data training a guidance counselor is going to have, and the student to guidance counselor ratio in schools is really, really high. And please don't try to lead this list, but these are the official duties, and you'll notice that help getting students to college is sort of only one of those. On top of that, if you're not immediately needed in a classroom in a US public school, you often get asked to do things like bus duty and lunch duty. And here, enter all these test scores from the last 16 years into our data system for us. So they tend to have a lot of really crises-like things and then administrative things that take up a lot of their time and eat into their time that they could be working with students. Then, and this has always been my concern from the very beginning of getting through this project, the thing is we're dealing with middle schoolers, and I don't know what your experience has been recently with the middle schoolers in your lives, but if you can have the nicest adult ever in the world, and if you add a sulky tween to the mix, or a teenager even to the mix, then you need help is very often going to be interpreted differently. And if we're lucky, the reaction is going to be something like, well, you know, this person thinks I'm stupid, I can't do this because I'm stupid. And if we're not lucky, hey, lady, you're stupid, and, you know, so is school. I'm done with this place, right? So this was sort of my nightmare scenario in working with this project, is we want to have things framed as positively as possible in a way that these guidance counselors have the most effective tool to be the immediate thing that they start the conversation with, right? So if you look at student feedback principles, there's a number of different theories that you can draw from, but the big ones seem to be to try to evaluate the task rather than the student, to, whenever possible, evaluate the evaluation should take place immediately after the task. Now, this may not necessarily be possible with a year-long longitudinal model. But, you know, certainly it's something to bear in mind as we're moving forward. And then thirdly, to use positively framed feedback for the reasons that we've sort of talked about before. And the research bears this out with students, right? So if you use positively framed feedback, you're more likely to see higher self-efficacy afterwards. You're likely to see improved performance. You'll see increased chances of them taking on more difficult and challenging tasks. And also, if you're working with an adult in their life, it improves the opportunities for them to set a really concrete goal to work with that kid. And so you're not just coming in with criticism, but you're saying, hey, this is what we need to try next. Okay? So for example, next time, why don't you try to get 70% right on the assignment? Like, maybe we're not going to get this kid to 100% right away. But you contrast that with something like the guidance counselor coming in and say, hey, you're failing all of your assignments. The first one's much more likely to be received in the way that we'd like it to be received. And when we start to deal with things like emotions, you know, how can we make this more interesting is much more likely to be effective than please stop being bored in your math class, which I suspect would never, ever, ever work. You never know. So this gets us to the design principles. And again, this is a slide that I don't want you to try to read all of. I'm going to sort of talk about these and tease these out as we go through here. Now, it's pretty clear from visual communication research that bar graphs are going to encourage comparisons, that tables are going to inhibit precision. These are actually things we want when we're reporting on an individual student with a model that isn't perfect. And so it became very clear that for us, the way to go was to use tables when designing the reports for the individual students, and then to use the pie charts to report the group data. They're not favored among the statisticians, but lay people love them, and they're really easy to use. Sorry, guys, I'm coming over a cold, so I'm losing my voice. The next thing that we looked at was labeling characteristics. And we talked about positive framing, but there are other issues to take into consideration. So some things in our society are so ingrained in our language and in our interactions that we don't necessarily even recognize them as metaphorical. But certainly the use of traffic light color schemes, like those that were used in the course signals, are very, very intuitive to people that are familiar with American and many other driving practices. But there are others, like up is good and down is bad and up is more and down is less, that we might not think of as metaphorical until you actually stop and think about it, just because it's such a common part of our description of language. We did really good with the traffic light signals right off the bat, and the others we kind of didn't take into consideration as well as we should have. And I'll talk about that in a minute. But the other thing that we really worked on is encouraging those fail-soft labels. And the guidance counselors felt this was very, very important. They wanted something that, you know, if I go to this kid and say, hey, let's work on this, focusing on that isn't going to hurt the child, right? It's still going to lead to some improvement, even if we're wrong or even if the kid doesn't want to go to college. Right? So we look a little more carefully at the designs, and we start with just the college enrollment forecast, which was pretty simple to design. We used sort of a modified traffic light scheme. Very, very intuitive. Nobody had any trouble with it. It didn't take any time at all to settle on it. But then we wanted to work with the learning and engagement factors. And the first thing that we needed to do, and we knew this from the literature, was to try to get the scales equal so that people can manage them. Because with the different weightings, that was going to be complicated. So what we did was adjust the weighting so that things like carelessness and knowledge, which were really important and much more heavily weighted in the model, were increased in their relative effect on the outcome. And things like confusion and boredom that were a lower level of prediction were decreased. We put this in a -1:1 scale and converted it to traffic light patterns by putting the yellow in the -0.3 to 0.3, and the green was the numbers above that, and the red was the numbers below that, scores below that. But the thing that we sort of flubbed was the up is good, down is bad, and that's because we hadn't, when we started this, fully transitioned to positive labels. And so when you start with something like correct, percent correct, carelessness, and boredom, this is pretty simple, right? But then they try to tease out carelessness and boredom, and if the opposite of percent correct is wrong and it's red, then these other things like carefulness and interested get interpreted as the lower end of the scale as well, and it causes a lot of confusion. Just to walk you through this, we look at something like, hey, you know, Joe's got percent correct as green, so he's getting lots of problems correct. Oh, well, if he's getting lots of problems correct and it's green, then he must be getting not many problems, careless. And, you know, parsing that even syntactically is a little bit challenging. And then we get to boredom, and he's green on boredom. I don't know what this means. And there was just a lot of confusion. We very quickly corrected things. And which had the benefit of reframing these things with positive things that allow us to set goals, but also cleans this up, right? So green is good, red is bad, green is good, oh, I know what he needs to work on. It's this red thing here, and we won't worry about the green things, right? The label changes that we made from carelessness, we relabeled to meticulousness. From knowledge, we relabeled proficiency. We ended up not using percent correct, ultimately, because we decided it was a less precise measure than knowledge, and that the duplication probably wouldn't help that much in deciding on an intervention. But number of first actions became high practice because we tried to say number of attempts and they thought they were failing all of their problems. Confusion became comprehension with boredom became interest levels, and then the negative labels are still given in small letters in each of these labels on our report, so that the actual opposite for terms that didn't have true opposites is still intuitive when you read the report. Right. Again, like I said, we think this is good because it helps with the framing of interventions. So how can we make this more interesting? It's probably more effective than stop being bored all the time and telling the kid to quit being careless. Or even you're just not practicing enough is probably less effective than going in and saying, hey, okay, this is our goal for how much practice we think you should need. Right. So this was the first column that we had on our reports with the college enrollment forecast. And then we did the learning and engagement factors, and we ended up adding gaming the system back in. It's now relabeled as sincere effort. And that was because even though it did not make it in the model, it was highly predictive as an individual item. And the guidance counselors felt like if they had a kid who was off the charts for gaming the system, that was a pretty quick intervention. And it might have a pretty dramatic effect, which we would like to see tested. But we are confident that it could have the potential to be a very, very important effect. And then the other thing that we made sure we had was the lowest performing factor. And that was, the decision was made to put that immediately after the college forecast. All right, so that if you have a format like this, right, I've just flipped these for you. So we have still the red and green traffic light signals for the things that are being measured, right? And then we're identifying the lowest performance factor by matching it to the column labels of those individual columns. It's a little bit busy, and the guidance counselors said this at first, but it was the system that worked best. Right? We then developed the pie charts, basically, or created the pie chart report using those learning and engagement factors. So if you had a particular group of students, say those in the seventh grade or those in the sixth grades, or those in the low performing math classes, those in the high performing math classes, you could run this sort of report and determine if you were going to go in and do a group intervention, which strategies were going to be most useful for that particular class or group of students. And again, just an overview, right? All of these things match or contrast depending on how related or unrelated they are. Okay. So we'll look again at a couple of example students while I still have a couple minutes left. So we'll look at a student who's in the 40 to 60% range, and we'll just give them a pseudonym. I don't think George is here, so it'll be a secret between all of us. And the next thing we see in George's report is that his problem is with high practice, right? That's his lowest performing category. And if we look a little more carefully, we could see, in fact, it's a pretty big difference compared to the other things in his learning engagement factor. So it is the only one that is lit up red. And probably the appropriate response here is, let's try to do 10 problems a day or so many problems a week or whatnot. It gives us a nice concrete goal. It may not get him to college, right? But it should help, even if he ultimately decides that's not what he wants to do with his life. Maybe he has other plans. All right, we'll also look at someone we'll call Rochelle McShamara. And she has a score here in the 60 to 80% range, which is pretty good, right? She's probably on track to college. But there still may be information in here that could be useful. So if we look at this and we say, hey, well, she's got really low interest level, even though her proficiency is good and her meticulousness is high, it may be that she is needing more stimulation. So maybe we need to move her into a more advanced math class next year. Or maybe we just need to work with that teacher to make sure that she knows that even though she's mastering all these things, she probably could be challenged a little more and it might improve her chances of doing better in the future. And then, of course, it's always good to know whether or not you have a classroom full of Georges or a classroom full of Rochelles, because that's going to change what strategy you are or you're going to have if you go in to work with a teacher or if you go in to do the intervention yourself. Of course, there's always the chance that they could be a more mixed group and your intervention strategy could change accordingly. But we see a lot of potential for this going forward. We think there still is certainly a fair amount to do. But going forward, we'd like to see more work on developing more fail-soft designs based on this information, working more closely with guidance counselors who actually know some of the students in the reports that we're working with so that we can get their judgments and determine which what goals and what interventions would be best suited for different kinds of students, different patterns of engagement and learning. If I were going to give this an alternate title, I think we would probably call it the framing of the ACPM reports to encourage fail-soft interventions by the guidance counselors, and we'd certainly like to see the field look at people besides just the classroom teacher when we're deciding who we could bring in and work with in terms of data. How can we best support students? Sometimes the teachers aren't going to be able to do it all by themselves and they may need additional support. And there are a number of other guidance counselor and guidance counselor-like administrators in campuses that might benefit from knowing these things so that they can get to know those kids who are at risk a little bit better and try to help things along, right? In future research, we'd like to see more field testing of the current drafts. It would be really interesting to see if we could have some short-term effects, maybe even just whether or not we're affecting the learning and engagement factors by these in a way that we could measure by the end of the semester or the end of the year, and then to follow those students a little longer and see if, in fact, we did change and create some sort of positive long-term outcome in their life, whether it be college or other measurable achievements. And like I said, we definitely would like to see this information carefully presented to other professionals in the field who work with the students. All right, I am almost out of time, so I do want to say thank you both to you guys for sticking around on the very last day in the very last session, but also to Ryan for his vision and patience with us as we went through this project. While he was trying to figure out what it was we could do to make things better, I was pretty much in panic mode, and he deserves a lot of credit for pushing this project forward. And also, we're going to plug that we have a postdoc position we'd like to fill. And sure, Philly is really nice, and I think you know people, or maybe are people, who would like to come see it for yourself. So thank you very much.
Questions?
I get to go home. Oh, no. Hi, Sydney.
Thanks for a really great talk. It really illustrates how difficult it is to take something, to get it right, to design mm-hmm. it properly. So I really appreciate all the efforts you guys have put in. My question is really more about making inferences on the causes mm-hmm. of the issues. So is your vision that, for example, if somebody is low in is high in carelessness, it could be that the guidance counselor has information. Do they have ADHD? Or they just don't care? Well, that'll come out in a conversation.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the challenges in giving these positive labels, is that they're not necessarily intuitive with the original labels, right? And certainly, I grew up as a child of a special ed teacher, and so I know all the disorders and have experienced some of them for myself. But it's something you really have to be aware of and to make sure that they're aware of, that we're not just, you know, brushing this off as, well, we've got this measure and it's absolutely correct. The other thing I would say was something like carelessness. It actually goes up the more you have correct answers. So some of these students who are on the lower end of the scale, because carelessness is defined as we got this right before and now we missed it in our detectors, it could actually be higher and we're not able to pick up the definition of carelessness that those teachers have. And so I would like to see us sort of expand both the definition in the report, but also to work on modeling other kinds of carelessness and other kinds of frustration, and other, you know, because all of these things have multiple interpretations, and that's something we need to take into consideration when we're presenting it, but it's also something that we should be thinking about as we're deciding what we're going to model next.
Do you think carelessness might be related to engagement?
Well, it's definitely related to learning, right? So to the extent that learning is impacted by engagement, then yes.
I have one more super difficult question.
Oh, he's been promising me all day.
So I appreciate you have this approach with fairly, let's put it, I mean, simple visualization, not overly too complex. But did you try something else in addition to pie charts, and why not?
Other forms, like bar graphs, are more like, bar graphs are generally good for when you want comparisons. The visualization research says that for lay people, the pie charts are really the preferred thing, and as long as there's not too many categories, it's actually a little easier to read. We also like the contrast from the individual reports. So,
thank you so much.
Thank you.